Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Dorsey Wright podcast. Today is Thursday, January 2nd, and this is our first podcast of 2020, first podcast of the new decade. And we'll starting off with a bang, right? The S&P 500 moving to intraday all-time highs at 3250 on the default chart, coming off the second best performance of the last decade with 2019, right?
Yeah, that's right, Eric. Finished 2019 with a bang, too, quite honestly. Yeah, as you mentioned, second best return of the last decade, the only better calendar year being 2013. And then some other neat things that we were seeing is that actually that was the eighth time out of the last 11 years that the market has posted double-digit returns. And then from a participation perspective, we saw 9 out of the 11 broad sectors finish 2019 with 20% plus gains, with the two not being energy and healthcare, perhaps not much surprise there. And then one more note kind of on the market strength. Bloomberg data suggests that the U.S. stocks have actually had the best risk-adjusted return of the past decade since the 1950s.
Wow.
And the risk-adjusted being measured by Sharpe ratio in this.
Okay.
So overall, strong year and strong way to end the decade.
Yeah, and that seems like an interesting stat to throw out there. You think about the elevated return profile you've had for the S&P 500 coupled with the risk-free rate, right? Interest rates have been low relative to their historic figures. So that is an interesting stat nonetheless. And if we look at the S&P 500 right now from a technical indicator perspective, and we see a couple of observations, right? Looking first at the BP for SPX, they're looking at the bullish percent or the percentage of stocks on point and figure buy signals in that index. We're at 74% in X's right now. Additionally, if we look to the PT SPX or the stocks that are trading in a positive trend in that S&P 500 index, we're at 80% in X's, right? So both readings above the 70% threshold, getting near the overbought side of that distribution for those indicators. And what we want to watch for here is any kind of reversal down into O's, right? As of today's action, as of recent strength, we're not in a position where we anticipate that, at least in the immediate term. However, that is typically what you want to watch for from a defensive perspective. So a little elevated on those indicators, but we're also elevated from an overbought, oversold perspective as well, too, right?
Right, right. So as you may see, that BP SPX, again, elevated, PT SPX, elevated readings. And that translates through when you look to the individual overbought reading of the SPX as a whole. Now, that said, those three all in elevated overbought levels, we'll say. But looking at WD SPX, which is the average weekly distribution for the SPX, and it's not average of the index as a whole, it's the average of the 500 names in the index. Mm-hmm. That actually reads at 24%.
Okay.
And that was an interesting thing that we came across this morning, perhaps suggesting that overall, given that the index as a whole itself is overbought, there are a lot of actionable names with that average reading of 24% of all 500 securities.
So coming back a step, Will, when we look at the index entirely, we're at 103% overbought, right? So heavily overbought for that index, as you mentioned, but you have this WD SPX showing a much more actionable level, right? And so if we take a step back, we mentioned this a couple weeks ago in our research and on this podcast. When you look at those two different readings, right, no surprise on that elevated number for the index as a whole, given the mega cap names have done very well, right? So a lot of those mega cap names are really skewing that overbought reading to the higher end of the distribution curve, whereas there are a lot of actionable names still kind of underlying that S&P 500 index. And one way that we can find those actionable names and kind of dig in there a little bit deeper is using the security screener on the Dorsey Wright platform. So if you go to the top of the platform, security selection, and then security screener, we're going to run a stock screen. We're going to look for threes, fours, and fives from a tech attribute perspective. We're going to make sure that those are trading on a point and figure buy signal with multiple consecutive buys. We're then going to ensure that we are only looking at threes and fours that are in a positive trend and on a market relative strength buy signal. And then finally, we're going to go to the bottom and put 70% as our overbought cap, meaning we don't want to see any positions that are heavily overbought. And when we run that screen, we get 102 names, right? So looking under the hood there, Will, what does the sector composition tell us about some of those results?
Yeah. The sector composition is pretty interesting, and it'll align with some of our more intermediate gauges on the platform, being that the results yield 24% of securities within the industrial sector. Mm. And then the second sector is actually tied, being consumer cyclicals and financials, each with 16% of their representation in that 102 names. So those three in particular are really carrying a lot of weight in that.
Yeah, and that is interesting because you mentioned looking at some of our other indicators and tying that together with our screen results. You know, if we flip gears a little bit and go over to asset allocation and asset class group scores, where we're looking at the fund scores on an average basis for all different groups around the market, if we sort by sectors and then view, we can see that those three groups are all actionable from a score perspective. They're all showing positive score direction, and they're all relatively actionable from an overbought, oversold standpoint, right? Nothing too heavily elevated there, which really ties up with the individual names that we pulled on the screener. So if we're looking at some ideas that are, say, fund-based, starting with industrials, which is the best group of the three from an average fund score perspective, we look at the iShares U.S. Industrial ETF, ticker IYJ, has a fund score of 4.37, which we consider optimal, and is trading on a fourth consecutive buy signal near an all-time high at 168. So that's a good sector to have exposure to. It's also the number two sector in DALI, which is our long-term asset allocation indicator. So what else are we seeing there, Will?
Yeah, so to round out the other two, being the financials and consumer cyclicals, or excuse me, consumer discretionary and consumer cyclicals. The first being financials, KBWB, the Invesco KBW Bank Portfolio ETF. Looks strong right now with a near perfect 5.79 fund score. Hmm. It is trading on three consecutive buy signals well above its bullish support line. And while doing so, is not in overbought levels, boasting a pretty modest 51% reading. Mm-hmm. And furthermore, the fund does come with a yield of 2.38%.
Up in the new 52-week high on that one too, huh?
Yeah, that's right. And then the one other one that would kind of round out our returns would be the First Trust Consumer Discretionary AlphaDex Fund, ticker FXD. And this is boasting an optimal 4.35 fund score with a strong score direction of 1.75, trading on two consecutive buy signals well above that bullish support line. And then also comes with a pretty moderate overbought reading of 56%.
Mm-hmm. So we compare these relative to the broader market, right? Definitely actionable, showing strength, right? You're not giving up any of that relative strength by looking at something that's a little bit less overbought. And I think that's really important right now, given the elevated position of the market, right? We're hitting new all-time highs, as we mentioned. You know, we've had a lot of participation across different size and style categories of domestic equities. So really important to be diligent, you know, use those tools on the platform to make sure that you make a decision that is going to put you in the best position going forward into the new year. So, you know, with that, just to wrap up, you know, going into the new year, we want to mention that we are hosting a research platform workshop in Boston. That's in March on the 19th, and it's a great opportunity to get together with a couple of the peers that are working on the platform, as well as some of the analysts here, to learn more about how to better utilize the research and then put it into practice. So if you're interested in that, please check our daily equity report or shoot us an email at dwa@dorseywright.com. We'd be happy to give you more information. So Will, with that, thanks for joining me today. For you all, we'll talk to you all next week.